Lecture is based upon Aristotle's theory of imitation. So let us have a look at what is imitation and what it is also called mimesis. Whereas the term imitation is concerned, Aristotle was not the first philosopher or a person who used this term. Before him, Plato used this term, and perhaps it is a part of history that before Plato, perhaps this was also used term in some form or the other. But Plato was the first person who gave it some significance, and whereas this imitation is concerned, so Plato gave it some dimensions, and then Aristotle also tried to increase its value on a larger canvas. Now, whereas the concept of Plato is concerned, and his most important idea is idea of imitation, and he describes it with reference to arts, and he divides arts into two types: useful arts and imitative arts. Imitative arts means poetry is imitative art, music is poetry, imitative art, painting is imitative art, and then this sculpture, that is also an imitative art. Then there are useful arts. Useful arts mean that agriculture is useful art, fishing is useful art, and then medicine industry is useful art. I mean that every type of industry is an art, and that is a useful art. And Plato was of the view that this poetry is a form of imitation, and it is imitative art, it is not useful art, because he was going to give a concept of an ideal republic and said that in an ideal republic there must be all those arts must be part of that republic which are useful arts. But this poetry, that is not a useful art, that is just an imitative art, that is just related with mimesis, so it is of no significance. And when he talks about truth or idea or reality, he says that truth lies somewhere else. Ideal form lies somewhere else. That lies with God. That is ideal form, and he was a first idealist. That ideal lies, ideal reality, ideal truth, ideal knowledge, that reality lies with God, and this universe which we are looking at or which we are observing with our eyes is just a copy of that real copy. And then poets, what are the poets going to do? They are going to copy this copy. Mean that is the first reality, that is lying truth or ideal reality, that is lying with God, that is first reality. This universe which is observable, this is second reality. And then the third reality is that this poet is imitating this thing. Poet's reality is twice removed from reality, so his whatever he writes, that is a copy of copy, that is a shadow of shadow, and that is also an imitation of imitation. And Plato also gave the example of a carpenter, that when he is going to make anything, the very first thing is the idea. Idea is in his mind, that is the real. Then the thing which he has made, that is the second reality. And if a poet is going to write about that, that is the third reality. So poet's reality is twice removed from reality, that is not real thing. So it is a copy of copy, it is a shadow of shadow, it is imitation of imitation, and it is an imitative art, it is not useful art. So he makes a critique of this all thing which is called poetry. And then let us move towards the theory of imitation by Aristotle. So Aristotle took this concept from Plato, and he was a student of Plato, but he was perhaps against, he was not going to accept his ideas of imitation on the face value. He gave to this concept new dimensions. And he said that poetry deals with universal and ideal. Plato says that poetry doesn't deal with reality, but Aristotle says that poetry deals with reality, ideal reality. It is not copy of copy, it's not shadow of shadow, it's not imitation of imitation. It is a representation of ideal reality. It is representation of truth. It is representation of what is actually essence of human nature. Because he says that poetry deals with universal and ideal. It doesn't take us away from reality. And then it is one of the fine arts. When it is one of the fine arts, he says that it is also a useful art. It is reproduction by poet. Poetry is production, and then it is also reproduction. Reproduction means that he is going to see something, he is going to observe something, he is going to imagine something, and he is then going to reproduce thing in a different manner. Then through imitation, poet makes something real. Plato was of the view that they copy this copy. Aristotle is of the view that they don't copy just they what they write, that is not just copy, that is not just imitation. Rather, then what is that? That is something real. Poet talks with the very essence of nature, with very essence of humanity, with very essence of man. It doesn't take us away from reality, rather it takes us to the reality. When it takes us to the reality, it means that it is the representative of real reality. This is the distinction between Aristotle and poet Plato, whereas the concept about poets, poetry and imitation is concerned. And then basic elements of man's nature mean that poetry talks about basic elements of human nature. It tells us the real essence of life. What is life? How is life? How to live life? How to handle life? How to move in life? How to grow and flourish in life? All these are the parts of the poetry, and poets are going to tell us. So whereas this concept is concerned, this poetry is also a part of imitation. It is imitation, but its mediums and then its objects of imitation and then its manner of poetic imitation, they are totally different from all other type of arts. Whether it is an imitative art or a useful art, it is art, and it differs from all other arts by keeping in mind the three dimensions: the medium of poetic imitation, the objects of poetic imitation, and then there is the manners of poetic imitation. So let us move towards the medium of poetic imitation. So painting is imitative art, music is imitative art, sculpture is an imitative art. These are imitative arts, but poet's medium is different from a painter's medium, because painter is going to use colors and brush, and poet is going to use words, rhyme and rhythm. It means that poet's medium of imitation is different from painting, but according to Aristotle, it is going to have an affinity, a relationship. We can say that it has something common with music, because in music there are two things which are most important: rhythm is medium of poetic rhythm of music, and harmony is also a part of music. Rhythm plus harmony, so both these things are also part of poetry. When poet when a poet writes poetry, he keeps in mind rhythm and harmony. But the thing that is different, differing music and poetry, is that a poet adds language and then it becomes poetry. But rhyme and rhythm, they are similar, like music's rhyme and rhythm. So medium of imitation, so whereas this medium of imitation is current, Aristotle says that it is different from other types of, it's different from painting, it's different from others, but it has some a little bit affinity with music, with reference to rhythm and harmony, because without rhythm and harmony there is no poetry. And then a poet adds language to it. Now this next point is the objects of poetic imitation. Objects of poetic imitation means men in action. So men in action, whereas this poetry is concerned, when then in the then society, usually even poetry, even philosophy was propagated, or philosophy was told to people in a verse form, and perhaps this poetic form was used by them. And then there was a tragedy. Tragedy was also a part of poetry during that era. And whereas objects of poetic imitation are concerned, it means that men in action. Now men mean that each and every man who is in this world. Now man can be better than common man. If man is better than common man, it means that that poetic form is going to be a tragedy, or that can be an epic. If man is lower than common man, and that can man can be, that thing can be a form of poetry, a form of comedy or satire. And if man is equal, sometimes so happens that the man is equal to the other other men which are part of the society, and that is mostly novel, but Aristotle is not going to touch upon that. So men in action mean that men can be higher than common men, men can be lower than common men, and here action means movement of a character from one position to the other, from A to B, because whenever a poet writes something, so men are there. If it's a tragedy, men are there. If it's comedy, men are there. If it is an epic, men are there. So movement of men from one position to other. Why movement of men? Because through this movement they are going to teach people different lessons, how to live in a society peacefully, how to flourish life. It teaches them social, political, moral, economical, ethical, all types of values through this action. This action means representation of life, and it is, whereas poetry is concerned, it is creative in nature, it is intellectual in nature, and poets are creators, poets are intellectual. They going to produce something new, they are not just imitators. And whereas this thing is concerned that art imitates nature, so art imitates nature doesn't mean that art is going to talk about just the things which are apparently seen by our eyes. Art is going to talk about the very essence of human life, the very essence of human life, the very nature of human life, the very essence of this life, the very essence of this universe. What is life? What is the essence of life? How it is existing? How it is moving? How it is flourishing? What is the purpose behind this? So all these are the part of poetic imitation with reference to these objects of poetic imitation. Then it is also going to present outer reality as well as inner reality. Whereas outer reality is concerned means that around us there are different types of systems are there. Political systems are there, moral systems are there, economic systems are there, ethical systems are there, then religious systems are there. Outside people, they are also having feelings, and poets, they are observing and absorbing all those feelings and emotions. Now they have their own inner feelings and emotions and thinking patterns. So poetry is a judicious combination of outward as well as inner life, so that there may usher out a beautiful life through in the form of poetry, so that poetry may tell us that how to move towards beautiful life. Then the third one is the manner of poetic imitation. So it also different from other things, from other imitative arts, with reference to its manner of imitation. So it means that the poetry have different types. It's different from this painting, it's different from sculpture, it is a little bit different from music, but here it has different types. Whereas this manner is concerned, it can be purely narrative poet, a poet who is going to just narrate something, that this thing happened, then this thing happened, this happened, and this is happening. He is just a narrator of something. And then there is that's called purity narrative poet. Then is a poet may speak as a narrative, sometimes he is a narrative, and sometimes he speaks in an assumed role. It means that he himself is not saying something, any other person is saying something in spite of him. Then whereas this thing is concerned, the poetry is a form of an action, mean that is called usually a drama, mean that poetry is going to be in the form of tragedy or comedy. There is going to representation of ideas, representation of all these things, but through actors, through action is involved. What the poet wants to say, he himself is not going to say, he is going to involve characters, and characters are talking and they're saying something, and then the purpose is fulfilled. Then so Aristotle says that this in theory of imitation, that poetry, it tells us the universal truths about life. It doesn't take us away from reality. It is not a copy. It is not imitation of imitation. It is not shadow of shadow. It is imitation, but actually it is recreation. It is reproduction. It is representation of the truth. It is representation of reality. It is representation of essence of nature. It is representation of life itself. It represents what actually it must represent. Then because it is a creative, it is a reproductive process, and poets could take things as they are. It means that poets, when they are going to write something, they can take things mean ideas they are going to represent, things as they are, things as they were said to be are things as they are to be. So this is a function of a poet. And then what is the most important thing is that poets or poetry tries to describe us what is possible according to law of possibility. And possibility means that what is possible for anything, for if life is, there is life, so for if there are problems in life, so what are possible solutions, how to cope with them, how to handle them. So Aristotle says that poetry is higher than history, because history deals with particular and poetry deals with general. Poetry is a thing which can be, there is poetry. Poetry is usually is a thing which has universal elements which can be accepted here, there and everywhere. When poetry is going to have universal elements, it means that it's going to talk about the very truth of life, the very reality, very ideal reality. It doesn't take us away from reality. And this is the poetry. When life raises problems, poetry solves them. Poetry is a kind of reaffirmation. Poetry is a type of consolation. Poetry is a type of a solacing thing. Poetry is a thing which comforts us. Poetry consoles us. Poetry gives us pleasure. If life is raising problems, poetry solves them. It doesn't mean that poetry is having ready-made solutions. Actually, it leads us toward those solutions. So whereas this Aristotle theory of imitation is concerned, so we have discussed it by keeping in mind Plato's point of view and then also of Aristotle. So Plato and Aristotle, they differ from each other upon this, the concept of imitation. And according to Plato, imitation means just mere copy of copy. But Aristotle says that no, it is not just copy of copy. It is actual and real presentation of the very essence of life itself and very essence of this nature. So poetry must be given preference over history and all other type of knowledge, because here does lie its value, and it can help us to lead a beautiful life.